for the invitation.
Thank you for the invitation. I'm gonna stand there actually to click. So my name is Julian, it's Elena and Leo. We're the three partners of Something Fantastic. And we would like to start, thanks for the invitation again. with the topic that you gave us, or that you gave for this lecture series. I mean, we tried to somehow, we will show two projects now, mainly. And resistance, I would say, is not necessarily a topic that we thematize a lot in our practice. But maybe it's a kind of underlying topic of our practice, you could say. The image we showed in the on the invitation is an image we took in on Capri in 2014. And for us, this image is somehow, this image of course is very contemporary. You could say, okay, this is 2014, you know, by the stuff people are wearing or whatever. Maybe you can figure that it's 2014, but it's also very not 2014, you know? It's something that could have happened like this 100 years ago, or 200, or 400. So it's all about the people and the kind of the relation between the people. And it is actually part of a series that we once were asked by a friend who wanted to publish a book on the future of architecture. And we collected some images together with some simple phrases of what is the future of architecture. And you can't read it now, but I will read it to you. It will tell, from the left to the right, up to bottom, it will tell stories, it will be elegant, it will be Arcadian, it will be dense, not everything will be aligned, it will be painted, it will be heavy, it will be as it always was. So it will be as it always was the image we took for that was that image from Capri. Saying in a way that, you know, it's of course it's a lot about form, like we architects, we discuss about forms and spaces, but in the end, it will be as it always was, about the people in the space. We will talk about these two projects, Making Heimat and Bitkom. And we will do a little excursion to Cairo on the Making Heimat thing. We will elaborate that a little bit. Making Heimat is the German pavilion at the Venice Architectural Biennale. I'm sure as you are so close to Venice, you've all been there. If not, it's over since 2 days. We're just coming from Venice. We just organized the dismantling of the exhibition. Actually, we did the dismantling of the exhibition because it was a really kind of, there was not much we could dismantle, and now it's being closed again. If you visited, you know what I mean. This is our office and in Berlin. And maybe some words to our practice. So, as mentioned in the introduction, yes, we're an architectural office, so we are architects, actually. So we don't call our office an architectural office. I mean, we say that we are trained as architects, but and all the things that we are concerned with and that we deal with are somehow related to architecture and to space and to spatial planning, to urban planning, to things that are not only discussed nowadays by architects but by a broader public, like the question of the right to the city, gentrification, you know, all these topics that not only architects should actually discuss but a broader field of experts and the civic society. So we somehow see our office as, yeah, so sometimes we say we're trained as architects, but we're not really, like, the things we actually do are not necessarily architectural. This is the only diagram I would like to show in the introduction, because when we started our practice, it was 2010, but it's actually started with our diploma thesis, which we started more or less to think about in 2008. 2008 was the financial crisis, and there were many terms at that time in the in the public discussion. One of them was the German term of Systemrelevanz. So the question,
like relevance to the system or relevant to the system.
Yeah, so everything was kind of questioned as for, is it relevant to our system or can we actually skip it?
Let it die.
So it was, I mean, at that time it mostly referred to banks and big companies and so on. But we somehow wanted to take that to architecture. We actually wanted to just figure out what is really relevant nowadays and how can we as architects, with what we learned or should have learned, how could we engage with all those topics that are around? And this is a slide that just shows the consumption of resources that we, humanity, need for our lifestyles. And you see that at that time, 1.4, we would have needed 1.4 Earths to sustain our lifestyle. So that clearly means we have to change radically. And even though it's something that we often hear, like whenever you go to a lecture by, I don't know, I was 2 weeks ago, I was by a lecture by the Entwicklungsminister, so the Ministry for Development in Germany, and all the lectures, they always start with, okay, we have to substantially change everything. In the end, it's really difficult to do it on a daily basis. But for us, this was kind of a... so this is the cover of our first book, Something Fantastic, which then also became actually the title of our firm, somehow, of our collective, you could say. And at that time, originally it was called Ways of World Making, Ansichten, Anregungen, and Something Fantastic für eine schönere Zukunft. And Something Fantastic was kind of the subtitle of our original kind of idea of what an architect should do, ways of world making, like making world. And then it became, somehow made it to the title, and then it became also our kind of own agenda of how we now would like to practice. And since then we have done many different things. We've been involved in many different projects. So on the upper left you see some book designs we do. Book design is still one of the most, for us it's one of the like most steady incomes, like we do a lot of book design. The graphic design for those books that we do is usually, usually the books are about topics that we're super interested in, so for us it's a nice way to kind of bridge income and kind of intellectual Auseinandersetzung, what is that?
Discourse,
yeah. So we have been doing that since 5 years, or 6 years now. But we also do exhibition designs, we do furniture, there's a lamp you see, produced by New Tendency, a company in Berlin. We do communication design also. You see the standards of Artec, which is a company founded by Alba Alto and others to kind of communicate and publish and distribute the idea of modern living. Since 2 years we're doing their kind of communication design. And another thing where, of course, you could say we wouldn't do it if it wouldn't be a company that we somehow also believe in. We do that, and we also do, I would say, more classic kind of architectural approaches. So you see, actually, is the resolution somehow?
I think it's just quite bright.
So if you would
go down a bit with the brightness, you might
see more. Push on with the brightness.
But I think maybe one could actually say that we've resisted to specialize on anything, because I think specialization as an office, it happens kind of automatically, because you do something and then somebody like, and then it's done. Like you do a project and people usually approach you and come and say like, I've seen this project and there's something similar I'm interested in, or like people, that's how they know you, so they ask you, they keep asking for the same things. So that's why I believe that you actually specialization as an architecture office happens quite automatically. And if you are not interested in specialization and like, or you take the decision that you don't want that, that you want to keep it broad, you kind of have to do that. I don't know, it's something that you really have to also work on. I think it, because the automatically it, you would specialize. But that's something that we want to keep. We want to keep that kind of, for us, I think it's kind of like a space that, or a room that we want to keep around ourselves, that we don't want to get narrower and narrower, because I think it gives us some freedom in the way that we act. Very practically, that we, when we are, that the relationship to a client is different if you have these different choices. You are more autonomous and you are more, I don't know, I think you are freer.
Mm-hmm. So the second project we will show will actually, we can discuss that actually. So Making Heimat. Before we talk about Making Heimat, we want to do a little excursion to Cairo, because we're also involved, we didn't show it in the beginning, but we're also involved in teaching. So we teach the Master of Art Studies at the chair of Marc Angelin at the ETH in Zurich, which is a program that since almost 10 years now focuses on informal development and the question of how, as an architect, you can actually get involved in situations that seem to be somehow out of your reach, or where you actually are. Sometimes you're in a dilemma as a planner, even, you know. And we just heard the speech by Aravena, Alejandro Aravena, who said that the big problem is, on the one hand, every week we build a city for 1 million people right now on the earth, because people are moving into cities, but so we don't manage that, which is a shame. But if we would manage, we would actually consume much more resources and emit much more CO2 than we would be allowed to. So we're in it's a super wicked problem, because we, you know, it's what do you do now? But this course is focusing on informal development. What you see here is more or less Egypt, and for the last 2 years, we were with our students researching in Egypt, and especially in Cairo. So here you see the delta of the Nile. And what you already saw here is that only the Nile is the fertile land in Egypt. So Egypt has a huge surface, but more or less all the inhabitants of Egypt live around the Nile in this little fertile strip in the Nile Delta, and also all along the Nile. And Cairo is at the edge, or at the beginning of the Delta. So here at the beginning of the Delta, here is Cairo. And what we in the first year with our students researched were the problematic of informal developments happening on the agricultural land around Cairo, because of course there's a lot of land in the desert, but that is mostly military owned, and you need a lot of infrastructure in order to make that inhabitable. So the problem is that if you would live in one of the desert towns which are being built, and we did that in the second semester, there will be a book on that as well, but if you would live there, you would be totally depending on a car and on a lot of infrastructure. So people rather settle along the Nile, close to the city center. And this leads to an incredible growth of the city and an informal growth of the city. So this is what it looks like, and more or less this is the old city of the downtown center. And all these areas here are kind of informal developments. You know, it's villages that became somehow part of the city through informal construction.
And the construction is informal because it's illegal, because it's illegal to build on agricultural land, like in most countries.
Yeah, so there's no urban plan on which people are building. People just build on the land. So that's what it makes it informal. And informal is a topic that in is of course also, you can discuss the term informal, is it actually adequate? But in a way we think it's adequate because it means that there's very little paper protocols, rules and so on involved, which means that it's really difficult to guide the urban development. There is still some leftover pockets of the agricultural land, which is usually then replaced by the informal development. And there are the desert towns. So these are the three, you could say, the three kind of situations or morphologies we're actually dealing with as urban planners. And what I'm going to show quickly are some excerpts of the book House in Cairo. And here again, you see the kind of the merging of teaching and researching and book design, actually, because we also we did the graphic design for the book, the cover, for example, here. You see the cover. But we were involved in the project from the beginning on as teachers in the beginning. And so this is one page of the book where you see this kind of, you still see the agriculture, the palms, the date palms. And then you see already a building here. And you might ask yourself, why is this building so close? Why doesn't it have any windows? This is because, of course, there is no planning, there is no certainty what your neighbor actually, or no reliance, what your neighbor actually will build. So what you do is you build a house that only has an open facade to the street, but you somehow assume that all your neighbors will do the same. So that is why all the first buildings are super close, because the neighbors will build right onto them, which leads to quite fascinating, in a way, formally quite fascinating situations. And here now you see the kind of structure in Ardileva. It's the area where we actually did the research on, or in. And what you see these lines here, which are the little alleys that kind of come to existence if you build on agricultural land based on the grid of the agriculture. And some impressions of how Ardileva actually looks like. So even though, of course, we are kind of, we approach it critically, like we look at it, we see the dilemma of the lost agricultural space, but we also see that it's just happening, and we somehow also have to accept it, we think, as architects, as planners, that things happen without planning. And there is also some beauty actually to be found in these neighborhoods. So if you look at the generosity of this high, you know, the high ceilings here, the kind of improvised but very rigid fruit stand, this kind of very elegant and minimal tent structure that people put up from very little material they use. I mean, the scarcity of material and the pragmatism of design is something that I would say we're definitely fascinated of, and we also try to kind of implement it or use it in our projects.
So it's very dense neighborhoods that come into being there, which is,
of course, you have
short distances, like compared to the formal developments in the desert. Also the climate within these neighborhoods is better because it's very shaded, because the streets are very narrow.
So here is another example of this kind of inside-outside space, which we really like, you know, this melting or this kind of breaking of boundaries where you extend the living room in a kind of a seasonal approach. So when it's not too hot, you can actually use that space. When it's too hot, you kind of retreat to the more inner core, just the opposite than how it is in our climate zones. And this is one of the one of these situations that you would typically find. You still see the fields, but then you see the buildings being built on them. And what you see here is another page from the book that shows, actually here, it shows the division of plots. So the plots are arranged in a way that the channeling system of water from the Nile into the agricultural land leads to this very narrow, long urban, or not urban, into this kind of very narrow, long plots that then are being, and such one plot is called a fedan, and these fedans are then successively built on top of, so in the end the urban structure looks like this, so you still see the agricultural kind of morphology in the urban morphology, and that leads to these extremely long, narrow alleys. So sometimes you have 15-story buildings on both sides of a street that is maybe 3-4 meters wide, extremely dense. In such a climate, it's maybe not the worst, but still there's of course a lot of insufficiencies in terms of public space, in terms of open space, in terms of green space. So that's mostly what we were actually looking at when we then tried to figure out with our students how a planner could actually be involved in such a process of informal development. So this is one of these 15 or a little bit less story structures.
The fields, like, do the people who want to build the house buy land from the owner of the field, or is it
So usually the field is a fedan is this really long and narrow strip, but then the fedan is subdivided in kirats, and kirats are usually around 10 by 14 meters, and this is the footprint of the urban development. So a house usually is a kirat, and in very traditional agriculture you would have on your fedan, different kirats with different fruits and so on. You know, you would have this kind of fruchtfolge. So this subdivision is then actually the grip that defines the dimensions of the house. So the house is usually around 10 by 12, because you have a little space in between your house and the next house, so you actually create a kind of a street in between. And you buy it, yes, you buy it and you build on it. We figured that there's surprisingly many papers involved in this process. So you actually you have a lawyer that kind of signs the notar, actually, that signs the papers of, okay, now it belongs to a different person. You also have architects, you have building plans, all these construction companies build these houses just the way they learned how to build in the very normal construction business. So they're quite sturdy and firm. You know, it's not fragile construction, it's really solid. But the only informal moment is, you could say, it's the first decision of turning agricultural land into building land. That is really kind of against the law, you could say.
And also the density then.
And the density, yeah. So there are some drawings also in the book, some research, okay, how does this actually happen? So what you see here is the mold for a pillar, because these pillars are calculated in a way that you say, so it's a concrete structure with brick infill, and these pillars are calculated in a way that you say, you ask in the beginning, you ask the client, the builder, how many stories does he in the end maybe want to reach, and then you calculate down, you leave away, you take out a 10 cent, so it's made of 10 centimeter planks of wood, and you start with, I think, 6 or even a little bit less on the top, and then every second floor down, you add one more plank of wood. So that in the end means that you can start a building that for the first 10 years only has 2 stories, but if you invest enough concrete so that the pillars and the base, like in the first 2 or 3 stories, are like 1 meter thick, you can actually extend gradually the building. So it's a question of, it's a kind of a speculation method. The more you invest in the beginning, the more you can gain in the future. And then we also looked at the plans, actually, of those houses. So how are they organized inside? Made a kind of research on that. All drew it, measured it with measurement tools and so on. And there are essays in the book about the informal construction. But again, here, another detail that we actually really like, you know, it's the painting of the underside of a cantilevering balcony, but the way how pragmatic color is used here is really beautiful, and it's something that in Cairo is very different to the normal construction, because normal construction is really not as pleasing, like, to us. As this informal construction. So this kind of pragmatism is something that we try to learn of. And here is a situation I won't go into, but this is the guy that we usually in such a situation we usually collaborate with NGOs, in this case Cluster, an NGO that tries to bring informal development on the map of Cairo, like on to kind of make the rights of people living in this neighborhood actually to give them a voice. And this guy is one of the developers, so this is an informal developer with a very kind of typical story, worked a bit in the, like, for 10 years in the Emirates, worked on construction sites, learned how to build, and the money he sent back and then he started to kind of buy land, built illegally and so on. So now he's back in Cairo, back in Egypt, and only builds on his plots that are not officially building land. And then there are the design by the students. I won't go into detail, but again, the idea is that we kind of accept the situation, but we try to bring in those qualities that we usually, as urban planners, try to kind of achieve, like urban space, green space, ventilation, cross connections, not these kind of 500 meter long alleys where you have only one way out, with the building typologies that the students were then developing. And this is a rendering, and so the idea of this project was to kind of create cross paths and to organize the stairs in a way that you could actually, with your neighbor in the future, share a stair and minimize the space used for stairs. So this as a little excursion on where we are kind of coming from, and also as an introduction into the project, one of the 2 projects that we would like to show you, the German Pavilion at the Venice Biennale. And this pavilion is based on a book, Arrival City, by Duke Saunders, a Canadian journalist who traveled, an economist actually, who traveled the world for his job. And he actually figured, and he did it in a really kind of convincing way, that arrival cities are really necessary for some kind of urban situations, and there is a difference between. So what he looked at was these kinds of neighborhoods that usually by municipalities are seen as slums, favelas, as shanty towns, like not so good neighborhoods, and usually city planners try to get rid of it. But what he could show is that if you look at the numbers, if you look at the income, the education, the kind of the status of infrastructure and so on, in such a slum, there is, if you look at it now and 10 years later, all the numbers are bad. So income is low, infrastructure is bad, education is low, and so on. But it's totally different people. So what he could show is that they have an incredibly high fluctuation, and these places are actually necessary for people to arrive or to kind of integrate into an urban economy, an urban global kind of economy. If they move from the countryside into the city, if they move from a poor country into a rich country, they need these kind of places. And also these places, to a certain extent, need to be a little bit shitty in a way. And so that was his kind of contribution. And the director of the German Architectural Museum in Frankfurt approached us, because we did an exhibition with him 4 years ago, and he asked if we would like to show or exhibit in the German pavilion this topic, without actually really knowing like how to translate, what does that mean for Germany. Because Duke Saunders also looked at German neighborhoods like Kreuzberg. Actually, he didn't use Kreuzberg as a very positive example, because he said that Turkish people who migrated to Kreuzberg are economically doing not as good as those that migrated also from the rural, from the countryside in Turkey into Istanbul or other bigger Turkish cities. So he uses Kreuzberg as a kind of a bad example, actually. But the question was, how do you now show that, or how do you, how could you with this concept kind of think about urban planning in Germany? Because the big topic at that time and still in Germany is, how do you actually create, on the one hand, housing, but more the question is, how do you actually create urban neighborhoods, or neighborhoods that would kind of allow people to integrate. So it was not so much about refugee housing, which became a little bit the topic because it was so prominent, but the bigger question was, how should urban planning and urban design actually react on the question of integration? And so what we did in this project, so they asked us and we said yes, so there's a competition, an open competition, everyone can participate. In the end, 5 or 6 teams present their projects in front of the Bundesbauministerium and the jury, and we won. So the stuff we did in this project was, the nice thing is that we actually did all the Gestaltung, we did all the kind of, you know, whatever was had to be kind of
designed,
we did that. So from the book, to the website, to the party, to the pavilion, obviously, we did all the design for the whole project.
We also decided like how we would like to display the statistics and the numbers in the project.
And these are the 8 kind of claims that the curators came up with. So we were kind of figuring the form and the communication of all of it, but the curators then came up with this kind of 8 claims of how an arrival city should be, and then there were examples of how this actually looks like in Germany, so where in Germany are actually cities, and that's maybe this a misunderstanding, but arrival city doesn't mean that it's a city, it's more a neighborhood. So it's Duke Saunders more talks about neighborhoods in cities than about really cities themselves. So there's a map, there are maps, diagrams, there are kind of report, documentaries about neighborhoods in Germany. For example, this one is the Dongshan Center. If Arno Brandenhuber, in case he showed his tower project in Lichtenberg, in Berlin, this is right next to it, so this was connected to the statement that arrival cities are a bit informal and a certain kind of informality is maybe okay. So that's how it looks like inside. There are the cities on the ground floor, super important that people kind of can create their business, that they have spaces to start their own business. So all these kind of documentation was done by the curators. This is a mosque in a former car mechanic garage in Offenbach. And then the question was, how do you translate that into the pavilion? And this is the German pavilion at the Giardini in its original state in 1909. And if you've been there, you know that this is not how the building looks like, because the building now looks like this. It was kind of transformed in the Nazi area into this kind of monumental, with this kind of monumental appearance, with the big peristyle in front of it. It was a bit higher. It was really the symmetry, all these things that kind of made it a monumental German pavilion. And yeah, so our question was, how do you now bring all these topics into this pavilion? How do you make an exhibition that works for the Biennale? And the Biennale, one should be aware that the Biennale is a public, but really public in the sense of a lot of people that are not from the field of architecture are visiting the Biennale. So it's important that you communicate in a kind of an easy and approachable way. And also there's a kind of a competition between all the pavilions. You have so much information, so you really try to communicate it in a you could even say in a bold way, like really immediate. And so this is one image of behind the pavilion, because what not many people know is that the German pavilion has a beautiful location on a kind of a waste hill at the edge of the Giardini. There's a cafe behind, you're overlooking the lagoon, there's a little forest almost. So our idea of translating the approach and the idea of what is an arrival city, you could say the accessibility, the openness, the kind of the easiness in a way also of the arrival city, we translated by actually opening up the pavilion, also to of course break somehow its symmetry, to create a space that could in the first moment be perceived as a beautiful open space. So for us, this is like the main characteristic of the arrival city, of the idea of the arrival city, that you kind of create this accessibility, that it's open, it puts things into relation somehow, puts people into relation, puts neighbors into relation. So our idea of translating that into the exhibition was opening the pavilion. What you see here are three of the openings. We had four openings, there's one more on the left side. And this is how the pavilion now, until 2 days ago, actually looked like. And you could say maybe the pragmatism of what we somehow see in the design intelligence of arrival cities, we try to somehow translate into our exhibition design. So the framing we needed, first we discussed if we could maybe just open the pavilion, but then for lateral forces we had to reinforce the opening. But we discussed with the structural engineer like the most simple way of how to do that, and in the end it resulted in this kind of metal structure that we painted green to not make it, to somehow remind of this kind of, you know, we thought of green lacquer of machines in a workshop, like in a carpentry workshop, where this kind of pale green is a very common color, and we didn't want this thing to stick out too much. Like there were people entering the pavilion who actually didn't know that the pavilion doesn't usually have openings, and they could also, and they did also, just appreciate the openness and didn't actually see it as a violent act, which we also wanted to
We actually tried to design as little as possible.
Yes.
The openings. Actually, the thing with the color was also, we first asked, can you just use the default color? Because it's of course it's against erosion, the color. You have to have some color. So like, can you just take the color that's the cheapest? And I said, like, there's no cheapest. You have to choose a color. So we're like, okay, good, then we're choosing a color. But it would have been fine in just whatever default.
So this is now, this is a corner that was really important to us, to have this kind of relation between two openings where the pavilion and the two walls meeting at the corner actually would dissolve, because you make the two openings so close to the edge that it would be almost like a pillar standing there. And then also for the design inside, very pragmatic, so all the texts, all these claims I mentioned before were just brought to the wall with glue, like with kleister. So
like with wallpaper glue.
With wallpaper glue. We did that actually ourselves. So we printed in our office on really cheap, like in a cheap manner. We used colored paper that we printed in our office on a black and white printer, and then we used wallpaper glue to put it on the walls. A very pragmatic, cheap method of communicating really kind of the claims in a basic and direct way. We had these plastic chairs, which are not to celebrate their form, but more to celebrate their performance, because we know these chairs from so many places, and they're really, really functional, because they have great performance because they're cheap, they are light, they are like they have not really an author, and of course there's people claim that there is an author, but it's really about the performance, not about the form. As the whole pavilion is not about the form. So there was a moment when we were actually, when we saw all the other exhibitions going up in the other pavilions, where we thought, oh my god, we have not, like, our pavilion is totally empty. What did we, how did we dare to propose that? But it was really about celebrating the space, not the form. So this is maybe, you could say, or yeah, maybe this is something that in architecture we think nowadays is a bit kind of, and became kind of overwhelming, the fact that we just always discuss the form, but in the end it's about space. It's not about the form. We need the form to create the space. But so I would say that this is a topic that in some of our projects you could say is kind of a topic for us. And then there's very pragmatic also here, because the pavilion was open 24 hours, we could not close it anymore. It's not doors that we put there, but openings. So we had to find a different security measure. And this is you might know it from construction sites, when in the night they have an expensive saw or whatsoever, something that could be stolen, they just hang it on the crane. So we did the same thing here as a security thing, to just have a flush and soup and put it up there so nobody could reach it. The catalogs, for example.
You could operate it with the hand and just put it up and down.
And yeah, so this is inside the chairs, and here you have the stones as a kind of a seating podest. Something that the stones, we need to now actually fill the holes again. We wanted to use the material that we anyways will need in the pavilion, to kind of make the furniture out of that, instead of actually building walls or whatsoever to bring there our that exhibition architecture, to kind of minimize the material input for the exhibition architecture. So this is another of these piles of stones in the refugee refugee housing area.
Maybe one could also say, for the graphic design, it looks now super self-evident if you have 8 theses, just put, and you want to express them, write them on the wall. But actually when you are in a process with curators, like discussing how can we display the theses, then it's also not easy to go like, just write them on the wall. Because, I don't know, if you want to display numbers or a situation, then it's also like, should we use a model? Or to express this number, there was also this idea, should we stack chairs on top of each other to express the number? And to just go and say, you can also just write the number on the wall. It's something that
I think surprisingly often, just writing something, but if you want to express something, just write it instead of making a graphic that is showing it with icons and arrows or shapes. Sometimes quite efficient, and even less confusing and easier to understand than just writing something. I think that's something that we do quite often, that we prefer to write.
So just 3 images that show again the kind of references that we use for our for our designs, and that I think somehow also shaped our way of designing things. So this is a shop in Cidade de Deus, Rio de Janeiro, that has this beautiful handwritten signs of all the things that he's selling. So this direct way of communication. This is a detail of Rio das Pedras, also in Rio de Janeiro, a step in front of a house where that is made from scrap material. Another thing that is really popular in favelas in Rio is this kind of fake, the printed tiles. We're still trying to figure out how we can use that in a good way, because in the end it's a bit difficult. It's more difficult to use the. I mean, this is the kind of trashy design that we somehow we see it all around, and we somehow try to respond to it, to make something out of it, to react on it, but not to just dismiss it because it's not nice. And another one, this is in Parauapebas, in a city in the Amazon rainforest, that is exploding in terms of inhabitants because there's a mine right next to it, the biggest iron ore open pit mine in the world, and the city grew from 300 inhabitants to 2,500 inhabitants over the last 30 years, and so the city center, so we were there with the students and so on, but here again you see a very typical situation on the market square in the city center, where pop-up restrooms are kind of furnished with the white plastic chair. Some images I will quickly browse through of the installation phase. So cutting of the for the beams. The beams not painted yet. The construction phase, and then the image of the central door, the beams. And actually this is one I wanted to show because of course the pavilion is under preservation, is on the list of to be preserved buildings in Venice. So in this whole constellation that was already quite tricky, another aspect was that this is a preserved building and you cannot just knock down some walls of it. But that was something that was really kind of a nice experience to, because we didn't have the feeling that we are really fighting against a lot of resistance with all the authorities. But on the one hand, on the German side, like the Bundesbauministerium, the Ministry of Building, but also the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, who is officially the owner of the pavilion, they were quite open. And it's a, I would say it's a political situation that maybe it's already history, but at that time it felt like, end of last year, it felt like, okay, let's do this. They all kind of wanted to open the pavilion. And even the Italian Preservation Authority like tried to be open to our suggestion. In the end, like when we already ordered all the steel for all the openings that we had in the beginning, which was all the way around, they actually said, a day later, they said, we cannot allow you the openings in the front facade, because the front facade is visible for all the neighbors, and we don't even allow the neighbors to put a nail in the wall, so you cannot open the front facade. And then we had a kind of emergency meeting with the Preservation Council in Venice, where we then made a deal saying, okay, we will, so they wanted this and this closed, and we said, we really need this view here. We need this view where the building is kind of disappearing. You know, the situation I mentioned before with the two kind of horizontal openings really close to each other. And in order to get this one, we had to promise them to not open here and here, so that they could now say, okay, the whole, the complete right wing is still in the original condition, not touched at all, but we still could get our opening here. And in the end, like in the first moment, we were a bit disappointed, but then in the end, we're actually quite happy with the situation, because the rooms here are, we have more wall space actually, and yeah. And this is just an image to show that, of course, opening the pavilion also means that you have a beautiful pavilion, a beautiful spatial experience on warm summer days. But of course, if it's rainy, if it's windy, you have some other things that you have to deal with. So you
it's
have
fascinating
to, for example,
how deep the rain goes into a building if you have an opening of 2.5 meters high or 3.
So so this is Laura Tinti, the main supervisor pushing out rain again. But for us, this is actually a discussion, and I guess that is something that you discussed also last week or 2 weeks ago with Arno, the question of standards, right? So the question of course, if you have a standard that kind of says, okay, all the beautiful, you have that certain temperature, and it's all kind of fixed and figured, and it's kind of standardized, we think that we are now in a situation where these standards actually kind of diminish our possibilities of creating amazing spaces. And actually also, not only ours as architects, but also people's opportunity or ability to just kind of create spaces. And so for us, this is also, we could also discuss, like, okay, how much do you actually accept? Like, how much rain do you accept on a rainy day? In order to, how much open space and openness do you achieve on a sunny day? And this is a summer exhibition, so we said, okay, if it would be a winter exhibition, we obviously would not open the pavilion. But it's mainly in the summer, so let's try it here. And this is quasi life from the construction side. They are now taking it down, or they're taking down the steel and take out the steel, and they will close it again. So this is this afternoon in Venice. Very quickly, I wanted to, from this arrival city idea, we then took the claims more or less into our this year's ETH course. And what here looks like a flying bird is the city of Offenbach, where we do the project with our students. And one thing I wanted to mention here, so Offenbach is a kind of an arrival city, I will not mention anything of that. But we will. What we're trying to do there is we try to take the references of the pavilions as a kind of a brief for a new urban development, which is urban, not city, not settlement. And of course, in the beginning with our students, we always look at kind of references of famous architectural references of how you could build in a very cheap way neighborhoods that would allow people to actually live and work somehow together. So, of course, a discussion that is being discussed a lot in Germany, but also in Europe at all. So there are references like these from the kind of the canon of architectural references, like the Lacca Tomasal project, building with kind of industrial materials and so on. But what we did in this case, and this would be maybe an input we could discuss also, for the question of resisting, is that we try to, with our students right now, we try to resist this kind of typical references that you would have as an architect, but we rather try to take spaces that we see in reality happening or kind of being built without maybe an architect or a planner in this case. So this is a building in the Veneto where you see a kind of a production, or you assume that there's a production facility behind this door, but then you see this very beautiful pergola here on top of it. So the merging of productive and living is something that we think, for example, in the Veneto, where we did an excursion to with our students, where we can find nice examples for that, references that are not usually part of the of our kind of field, of our, as architects, of our field of expertise. This is another example of a building, a furniture shop along a highway, but here in this case it's a really, really nice detailing with very elegant pillars. This is a Marchese from textile that you can, a shutter that you can roll down here, and then it's red, it has this red reference on the top of the kind of the architrave. Here you see this beautiful, very pragmatic solution of the handrail, where there's a step in the floor, so you have a step in the handrail, but in a way it also looks like the two beams are lying on top of each other. So we're looking for these references in the not design, we could say, to now create these integrative, or this kind of urbanism that could actually allow people, that is so cheaply built in a way that it could allow people to actually start something there. And that is something that we also try to evaluate now in our office. How can we actually build with industrial materials that are not meant to be beautiful, but can we actually create spaces for that? So this is a company called Premak. We were asked by some people in Rome to give a lecture and to design a house for the Roman countryside, and we decided to actually use this system of prefabrication, which is highly efficient, of course, but where we assume that it somehow has the potential of generating really generous spaces. So this is their Pantheon roof that we then... I won't show you this, I think we're over time anyways. We wanted to show you one more project, which maybe could then lead into a discussion, at the question of how do we actually practice as an office? Like, how do we see the what Elena mentioned before? How can we, as architects who are kind of practicing architecture without really building, how could we make this into a practice that really is a practice that thinks about space, about uses, programs, the city, and so on, all these things that we're actually thinking about, but how can you make a a living from that. I mean, of course, there's academia. You can somehow try to be in academia, and then you can do your stuff. But then it's a kind of, you know, financed by the state, and that only works as long as the state kind of says, okay, I want to support something like that. But what we're interested in is, I mean, we really like working in the academia, but we also think that it's important that you kind of create situations as an architect that allow you to approach a brief of a client, because in the end, you most of the time have a client, and not many people have Ronald Huber's courage to become their own kind of developer. But in the end, you very often have a client, and we also think that it's not bad to have a client. So we, in our projects, we usually have this kind of input, you know, to have someone, you have these ideas of architecture, the city, of design and so on, but you don't know really how to make a, to make that really graspable or make something out of it. And so it's good if a client comes and asks you to do something. So in this case, a client approached us who has an office in Berlin, and the office is around almost 3,000 square meters, 150 employees in the center of Berlin. And first they wanted to move to a different building, and they asked some young officers to for a pitch. So a pitch is not really a competition, it's more briefer than a competition of a first idea of how they would do the, how these young officers would do the new space. And then they decided for us, but then somehow the negotiation with the owner of the new building didn't work well, so in the end they decided that they will stay in the old building. So the question, but they decided for us. So they asked us, how would you actually transform our office into something new? We still want all the new things that we asked in the beginning, and they asked for all the new things that an office that works in the digital industry could somehow think of. You know, they think
a
of
gym,
Google, and
a cafe, a gym, a belly band, hammocks,
and kicker, and you know, all these things that new offices now want to have. But in reality, it looks like this. So this is their office. They have what all normal offices kind of have. They have the suspended ceiling, and the floor is also kind of, it's an installation floor. They have all these huge desks that were originally built for big screens. In the meantime, now they have smaller screens, and they are kind of working in the digitalization, so they are quite digital for a kind of a normal conventional office, but they're still not really there. So some impressions of how this office in the center of Berlin now looks like. Huge hallways for of course, fire regulations and so on, but you have this strict division between the hallway and the office. And then inside the office you have, you have all these materials like carpet and wallpaper and fire detector and the ventilation and the floor. This is all this kind of detailing you have. But something here that we actually started to appreciate, where a not structural wall
and a not structural ceiling
meet each other in a not structural way, where nothing fits, which for us it's actually became then. Over time, in the beginning, we were like, oh my god, that's exactly the kind of the not, this is what the architect tries to avoid. But in the end, it's something that we actually started to appreciate. But I will tell you what we did in this project. So they asked us, okay, could you now please do a design for our office? As I said, 3,000 square meters, quite big, so as a young office, as we are, and we're not a big office, we're a small office, so we work in kind of, when we need to do collaboration, or we meet other disciplines, even architects, like in Venice, we collaborate with architects on site, and yeah, we would like to also do that in the future, and this is a project where we actually really thought about, okay, how do we, what is our role in this whole process? So the client, as I mentioned, wanted all these things, all these new programs in his office, and he wanted a kind of total makeover. And but what he also needed, and this is something we kind of asked him also to do, is we have the feeling that they didn't really figure what they really need. Like, do they really need hammocks? Do they really need a kicker? Do they really need a gym? So what you usually do is, before you actually write the brief for the architect, you talk to consultants, you do a kind of a organizational consultancy. This is very typical in office design, that you have a consultant that in the end will tell you, okay, you need this and that many open space. If you look at this office is, and you saw the images, this office is a super normal office. So maybe 95% of all offices in Central Europe look exactly like that. So, and we also assume that maybe 80% or 90 or 70, doesn't matter, a big proportion of those people working in such kind of offices would actually prefer to work in a more hip kind of office. You know, they are not really appreciating their office. And so for us, this case was a kind of a prototypical case. We thought about this office, but we also thought about all the other offices, and we had in mind all the material resources, you know, all the effort that is necessary to transform all the other offices as well. So our idea was that we maybe want to propose them a kind of an approach that would focus on some interventions, on some specific locations, and would somehow let the rest untouched. So this was the basic idea. But in order to actually make a living from such an approach, because the problem is, as an architect, usually you get paid according to the investment, right? You get a sum of, or you get a proportion of the sum that is being invested. But our idea was that we want to convince them to not invest so much. So that would be something that, as an architect, is stupid. Like, it's like you're shooting in your knee. Like, it's not good. So that's why we got in the futurologist, and we asked the, and we told the client that we will now develop a kind of a brief, a study on his office, that will somehow result also in an idea of space. But it will mainly be also a kind of a consultancy on how the client could in the future work in his office. And in the end, it was this Über das Arbeiten heute with Ludwig Engel and Stefan Karlsson, the two futurologists, where we then had, like, it's maybe 100 pages thick, and we visited a lot of other offices and looked at, we did interviews and so on what's the future of, maybe, yeah, what's the, not the future of work, but what's the kind of work that this office does, and how could we somehow relate it to other offices, and how could we learn from other offices. And so these are the 10, kind of the first five claims are the claims that are more referring to how they should work, and the second five claims are the claims that